Good evening, everyone. Benedict Lecker here, the director of the Redwood Library, presenting from the Redwood Library in Newport, Rhode Island. I want to welcome everyone this evening for another command performance by none other than someone you know well, Dr. Edward Markward. He is the music director, chamber orchestra of Barrington at St. John's, conductor laureate, Rhode Island Civic Chorale and Orchestra, professor emeritus of music, Rhode Island College. And he is continuing with a tradition at the Redwood Library, which is to guide us, ignorance like me, through the thicket of classical music. And so he's continuing his popular series. This is gonna be 12 lectures, no less, starting this month through August of next year. So it's the long haul. And we're grateful because he's so good in showing us all of the subtleties and all the things that are lost to me in any case. So tonight is the later 19th century part one. And it's Franck, Fauré, and their French contemporaries. So without further ado, I want to welcome everyone. Thank you. And thank Dr. Markward for what I'm sure will be a very fine presentation once again. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Benedict, and welcome everybody as we begin the sixth year of these music appreciation talks. Today, we're going to talk about French music, specifically César Franck, Gabriel Fauré, and a couple of their French contemporaries, and one predecessor, actually. As we discovered in talking about this particular period of time, the late 19th century, in other spheres, such as Italy and Germany, there are fault lines that come to exist between the various genres. For instance, do we do old music or new music? Do we do absolute music or program music? And in the last talk that we had, we talked about Franz Liszt and Richard Strauss and program music and the discussion or debate that went on at that time between absolute music a la Brahms or program music a la Franz Liszt and Richard Strauss. Also coming into play at this particular time, the latter part of the 19th century, we now have to deal with national versus international. And specifically to French composers, they debated amongst themselves and at the academic institutions and concert societies and so forth, whether to assimilate Bach, Beethoven, and Wagner, for instance, or pursue a more national idiom. This is also happening, as we'll find out in subsequent talks. It was debated also in Russia, a la Tchaikovsky and the Mighty Five, which included Mussorgsky and Borodin, Bohemia with Dvorak and Smetana, Scandinavia with Jean Sibelius and Edvard Grieg, and in England with the likes of Frederick Delius and Edward Elgar, and later Vaughan Williams and Benjamin Britten, and so on. Nationalist schools in these countries developed or emerged in both instrumental and opera. Many composers, however, avoided overt nationalism and composed in a style that at least they thought was cosmopolitan or international or a universal musical common language. Competing currents also at the time, beginning about now in the late 1800s, as exist today, there are competing elements in the forms of entertainment music, popular music, or in those days, popular song, folk music, and utilitarian music, i.e. marches or waltzes, for instance. It's good for us to remember that Anton Bruckner was living at the same time in Vienna, writing his nine symphonies, as Johann Strauss Jr. was living in Vienna, writing a gazillion waltzes. France had an advantage as far as nationalism was concerned as compared to Germany or Italy. If we remember, Germany became a unified country in 1871, Italy in 1870, and we remember that Giuseppe Verdi had a great big part to play in that unification of Italy. On the other hand, France had been a unified state for centuries, and it was a leading musical nation since the Middle Ages. Germany and Italy looked to music and other arts and other culture to unify them, if not in political fact, at least in culture. The concert institutions, therefore, in France and principally Paris, which was the great center of music in these times and has been for quite some time, there was an increasing interest in German music, especially in that of Wagner and his chromaticism. There was also a concern for France's musical heritage and an encouragement of native composers. And we're going to take a look first at Charles Gounod, who was a predecessor to the guys that we're going to talk about tonight and had a great influence. As a matter of fact, Debussy called Gounod the representative of French music during his lifetime. Also involved in this is a rather political influence that comes from the fact that government, unlike in the USA, government sponsored the arts, the operas, the instrumental music, the conservatories. They poured money into the arts and therefore influenced what was heard and what was actually composed. New editions of old music, for instance, of Rameau or Gluck, came out and sponsored by the conservatories. Ironically, the music of J.S. Bach had a great influence on all of these composers we mentioned because they were all organists at one time or another in their careers. And so there's an improvisatory style going on in many of their works, and it led to a new form of building organs in France, because of the improvisatory style and actually the symphonic way of composing for the organ. And that continued right up into our time, at least until the late 20th century. The two composers tonight are César Franck, who is a more of a traditionalist and represents the cosmopolitan side of the ledger, and Gabriel Fauré, who was considered a radical and represents the French school, which will lead on to Debussy. I would like to play a couple of works of Gounod, and you can see there's an influence, I think, of at least Mendelssohn in his work, so it's a bit Germanic. And we're going to start with a recitative and part of an aria from Gounod's great opera, Faust. He's best known for organ works, oratorio, and two main operas, Romeo and Juliet and Faust. This is sung by the great baritone Cheryl Milnes, who had a big influence on my life, my musical life as a young singer. Cheryl would come to my town, Des Moines, Iowa, and rehearse with his accompanist there, someone we're going to talk about a little later, accompanists, that is, how they became collaborative pianists, and we don't refer to them as accompanists anymore. But I was a great friend of the pianist John Spong, and so when Cheryl would come to town to rehearse a recital, I got to go to the rehearsals and witness 3 or 4 hours of these rehearsals, and that was worth the price of tuition to anywhere. This is from Faust as Valentin, the brother of Margarita, the heroine of the opera, is about to go off to war, and he asks that God take care of his sister, Margarita.
Thank you.
And so it goes. I should mention also, Valentine was the opera in which Cheryl made his debut at the Metropolitan Opera. And many years after I got to attend his rehearsals, my wife Diana studied with Cheryl for a period of a month or so. I owe a great deal of debt to him. We both went to the same university, and that's where the resemblance ends. There's another piece I want to play for you of Gounod, and it's a little piece I'm sure most of you who are of a certain age and owned a TV set in the 50s and 60s may recall, following this march, the death march of the marionette, funeral march of the marionette, there was a gentleman would come on and say, "Good evening." Notice, if you will, that I deftly avoid saying that a bald guy came on and said good evening. Next, we move to César Franck, one of the giants of the latter part of the Roman of the 19th century in France. He was actually born in Belgium. He came to Paris to study at the conservatory, and then in 1871, he became professor there, where he remained for 19 years until his death in 1890. He worked mainly in instrumental genres, organ and oratorio, much like Gounod. He blended into a distinct style, traditional counterpoint and classical forms, Liszt thematic transformation, and we're going to talk about that again, because what happens in these French works, especially with Franck, and to a certain extent with Fauré, we talked about symphonic transformation when we were talking about Liszt's tone poems, and how he started with a singular theme and developed it into a whole piece in one symphonic form. And it all stems back from Wagner's Leitmotif, in which it has programmatic content, and also in France from Berlioz, the Idée Fixe, and in both of those cases, they depicted some part of a program or a narrative. In Franck's case, this symphonic transformation or motive running through various movements, in all movements practically, is used as a unifying device to give us one unified whole. And this romantic idea of cyclic unification becomes prominent throughout the end of the 19th century in France and later. His works were for piano, organ, oratorio, and then symphony as well. His improvisatory style, as I said, inaugurated this whole new way of composing as well as building organs in France. And I think when we get to the symphony, you'll think, as we did with Bruckner, that his symphonic writing resembles somewhat writing for the organ or the sound of the organ, the colors of the organ. We're going to listen to a movement from his great sonata in A minor for violin and piano, which was written in 1886. It's unusual in that it has four movements. His symphony is therefore unusual in that it has only three. He used Baroque and Renaissance kinds of works like canon and fugue and chorale in his works, but he also used Wagner-like harmony. The last movement, indeed, begins with a 37-measure canon or round between the piano, which is the leader, and the violin, which is the follower. It's absolutely a wonderful sonata. I hope you get the chance to hear it all sometime. It's terrific. The last movement. Very tuneful. That again, so you can hear carefully how this follow the leader happens. Piano first, then violin. I think you can hear then that variation kinds of things and expanding on the theme, and a lot of passage work or faster work occurs from that point on. And at the end of the sonata, it all comes back again with a very climactic ending. Thank you. And strangely enough, I was shocked about 30 years ago to hear this same work played in a version for cello. And if you like that instrument, Harley, there is a recording out by Yo-Yo Ma, so you might want to get that. In the symphony, we've already discussed what sort of goes on. It is the most famous French symphony and most performed French symphony since Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique. And it's also one of my favorites. What you want to listen for here at the beginning is a very insistent motive of three notes, which begins at a very slow and quiet dynamic in a very slow tempo, and then is used as the main motive for the main theme. And it's in minor. It's in the symphony in D minor. Along about 6 minutes in, he introduces the second theme, and it's a major key, and it's a very lyric sort of a passage. Here is the first movement of the symphony in D minor by Franck. Remember those three notes. Here they are again. And then he repeats that whole slow introduction going into the fast again. Here, I hope, will lead to the second theme, which is very lyrical, quite contrasting. Thank you. and he develops it from there. I want to play a bit of the last movement for you. Typically, French is the use of two trumpets, which we find in almost all orchestral music, from Bach on, developing out of a Renaissance medieval instrument, the cornetto. The French continued in that style. It's a brass instrument called the cornet. The difference between a cornet and a trumpet is the cornet is conical, meaning the bore grows and gets larger through the tubing, whereas for the trumpet, it remains basically the same throughout. Therefore, the trumpet is a more piercing instrument, and lending to what we know as the French sound is this use of the cornet, which is a much more mellow kind of sound. And on that second theme that we heard, Franck actually uses the cornet to double the melody line, but uses the trumpets for punctuation and exciting rhythmic things. So here's a bit of the last movement, and it starts out with both the cornets and the trumpets, followed by the full orchestra. Cut to the end and hear this exciting finish. Andrew Davis and the Philharmonia of London. To sum up about César Franck, you could say this both about the sonata, probably the organ music, and of course the symphony. You're left with an impression of surpassing beauty, emotional power, song-like themes. I think we noticed that in the symphony and the sonata. that these are very melodic works and very expressive climaxes. That was the cosmopolitan side of the late 19th century in France. We now go to the very French side, which is Gabriel Fauré, one of my favorite composers. I have thought of Fauré for a long, long time, even though they're separated by almost a century. I thought of Fauré as the French Schubert. He excelled in the song genre or the chanson, and I think they're absolutely beautiful. Before we get there, I want to play a couple of larger instrumental pieces for you. Fauré drew on earlier French composers from Couperin all the way to Gounod. He was a real student of Gregorian chant, of the Baroque, and of the Renaissance music. His music is more sonorous than it is expressive, I think. His goal, as we will see when we look at the songs that he wrote to poetry of Paul Verlaine, that he's interested in imagery. If there is a poem or an idea, he wants to create the background or the scene behind what the poet is saying or the singer is singing, or in the case of the instrumental music, the mood in for instance, Pelléas and Mélisande, which we'll hear momentarily. He wants to create this mood. Order and restraint are the order of the day for Fauré. Not to say he can't be exciting, but because he certainly can. But he's interested in colors and tones and rhythms. And his sound is much more lyric than other composers in other countries at the time. And as opposed to, say, Wagner, his melodies are more dance-like and more homey than epic and dramatic as Wagner's or Brahms, let's say. He studied, may have stuttered as well. He studied under Camille Saint-Saëns, and he held various posts as organist. He was a co-founder of the Société Nationale de Musique, and he was considered, for those of us who love his songs and have sung many of them and listened to many of them and think that they're really nice songs, he was considered a radical by his contemporaries, and as we shall see, he became the currency for French music after his death. Moving forward to Debussy and Ravel and so on. If I could move on to Pelléas, I think one thing that we notice about the French composers, and this is true if you listen to Debussy and the Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun or the Piano Preludes, any of his music really, La Mer, we're dealing in pastels rather than colors that hit you in the face. He wrote the incidental music to a play by Maurice Maeterlinck. The play was not very well received, but he derived a suite from this incidental music. We're going to play part of that now. It's not to be confused with the opera by Debussy, who wrote a full-length opera on the topic, and it is indeed titled Pelléas and Mélisande. But the plot, the story, appealed to the composers, not only Fauré, but Arnold Schoenberg and John Sibelius as well. I'm going to play the opening of that suite for you. This is the prelude, and it's very, very subtle, I think you'll agree. Ahead of myself. Prelude. It's absolutely wonderful music. Diane and I have been going on walks with our puppy in the evenings and have seen some absolutely marvelous pastel colors in the sky at sunset. That was before the smoke hit us. And I think this music, you can almost manufacture in your mind's eye a sunset or a sunrise in pastel colors in the sky. The next movement that I will play for you is called a Sicilienne, and it is a dance form inherited from the Renaissance. It's sort of a three waltzy kind of feeling. It's very, very lovely. So on. I'd like to move now to what is probably Fauré's most famous or popular work, which is a strange word, I'm sorry, for his Requiem, Opus 48. I'm going to play a couple of movements for you. He wrote this, as he said, I just wanted to write a Requiem, even though it was a couple years after the passing of both his mother and his father. He said that this had nothing to do with his wanting to write this particular Requiem. It was written between 1887 and 1890. Fauré, by the way, lived till 1924. When we think of Requiem, we think probably of Verdi or Brahms or Berlioz, which tend to portray, especially the Verdi and the Berlioz, the horrors of death, whereas Brahms, for instance, wants us to feel comforted. It's about comfort to the living. Fauré is about acceptance, and it's a very intimate acceptance I think you will agree when you hear it how intimate it feels, as if the composer is talking individually to us and trying to have an intimate and comforting conversation with us. There are three versions in existence, basically. The first one was for organ, timpani, strings, harp, and a boy soprano or a treble, as they were called, because at Saint Clotilde, where Fauré was organist and choir master, women were not allowed to sing at that time in the choir. He then added some brass instruments in 1893, and finally, toward the end of the 1890s, his publisher asked him to orchestrate for very large orchestra, and that's the version we will hear. It's Robert Shaw and the Atlanta Symphony. I tend to really like the original version, or perhaps the second incarnation, the chamber. I think the version, both of them are more intimate, I think, than the large version. But then I feel that way about a lot of works too, including, for instance, Appalachian Spring of Copland. I prefer the original 13 instruments, but that's my personal take on things. This is his most famous work, and we're going to listen to the Sanctus, which is absolutely a wonderful setting. And what I want you to wait for also, as we listen to the text as it begins in this intimate level, the explosion of sound and how he builds to the Hosanna. How could I possibly stop in the middle of that loveliness? Notice the violin solo obbligato there. Karen Jackson Geary, that's for you. Longtime friend of mine who is a violinist. I want to play one more movement. This is the In Paradisum or In Paradise. And we have the same sort of pastel coloring. And I think you can imagine the painting here is just perfect. Wrong composer. One of the people that Fauré had an influence on was Maurice Durufle. And so I want to play part of the In Paradisum from Durufle's Requiem, written some 40 years later. I think you can hear that the approach is the same. The harmonic vocabulary for Durufle is probably a little more advanced, but I think you can hear that out of Fauré's roots, that it leads directly to Durufle. Also, one of the great song composers whose entire reputation rests on 13 songs, and that's Henri Duparc, who also was a little bit later. Fauré, as I mentioned earlier, became the greatest of the French song composers, and his most famous work in that genre is La Bonne Chanson, or The Good Song. It's a cycle of 9 songs to poetry by Paul Verlaine, and I'd like to devote the rest of the time here to these works. I'm going to play 4 of the songs. And later in his life, notice in all these examples by Franck and Fauré to date, that there are beautiful singing kinds of phrases, whether it's in instrumental music or in vocal music. Here in his later years, and these were written from 1893 to 1895, or thereabouts, that Fauré begins to break up the phrases into smaller units and paints each little separate part of a phrase with a different harmonic underpinning. I would also like to point out that the piano part is integral and a real partner in these songs. And today we have a term that I'm glad has come about. It's called collaborative pianist rather than accompanist. The old saw is that only singers would refer to a pianist as an accompanist when the pianist played 1,000 times more notes than the singer sang. So when you listen to the great piano collaborators through the ages, from Gerald Moore to our present time with Martin Katz, John Wustman, Eugene Liszt a little earlier, these pianists, and in our own state, we have several, including Michelle Beaton, who is Diana's collaborative pianist. They know the repertoire, the text, the underlying poetry, the matching music, as well as the singer. They do not just sit down and play piano parts. It's a real collaboration. And from that collaboration comes some of the most intimate and wondrous music making you can imagine. When you listen to these songs by Fauré from La Bonne Chanson, try to imagine and listen to how the piano interacts with the vocalist, and also how it complements the poetry. And I will give you the first stanza of each of the poems. Give me just one second to get set up here. The first three I will play in order, because they're in order in La Bonne Chanson. And then the last one is number 9 in the cycle. And I should point out that the ordering of these to make sort of a narrative is Fauré's own. They're not in the order in which they were presented by Paul Verlaine. The first is Une sainte en son auréole, a saint in her halo, a châtelaine in her tower, all that human words contain of grace and love. Listen to how, if you will, to how the painting occurs in Fauré. This is a precursor to Debussy's painting and therefore Impressionism as a whole. before going on, listen again to the pastel kind of sunset like imagery that Fauré is painting here, and that the poems paint as well. Verlaine was known as a symbolist, and that means that we have imagery not always word for word describing action necessarily, but in the case of these poems, the beloved is always compared to an image in nature. The next one, Puisque l'aube grandit, since day is breaking, since dawn is here, since hope, having long eluded me, would now return to me and my imploring, since all this happiness truly will be mine. Again, at dawn, the rising of the sun, the excitement of the day is translated into this poem about his beloved. And it goes on. Sorry, we're running into the hour here. So I will skip the third one and go to the last one. L'hiver a cessé. The winter has ceased, or the winter is over. And again, the comparison to nature. Winter is over, the light is soft, and dances up from the earth to the clear sky. The saddest heart must surrender to the great joy that fills the air. I hope you can hear how integral the piano part is to the presentation of the imagery of the words. It's stunning the way this is done, and that's very hard piano music. I'm sure you can understand that. It would be very easy without a superb pianist to overpower the singer with all the notes that are in that and in the second example that I played for you. Two other composers, which I will briefly mention, are Vincent Dindy, that's Vincent D apostrophe I-N-D-Y, and one of his great works is Symphony on a French Mountain Air. French Mountain Air, meaning a French mountain song. And the other is Reynaldo Hahn, who was actually born in Venezuela, but moved to France. And he was another in the long line of the emanating from Fauré that became a great, great songwriter. So if you have the opportunity, Hahn, H-A-H-N, and Dandy, D apostrophe I-N-D-Y. I think you will enjoy those. And I look forward to seeing you the next time on October 14th, I believe. And we will talk about Tchaikovsky and the Mighty Five, being Borodin, Mussorgsky, Rimsky-Korsakov, primarily. Thank you all for coming. I appreciate it. No end.
Dr. Markward, always amazing. What you bring to our understanding and appreciation, I mean, it's remarkable. It really is. So I'm so grateful that you have given us another fine performance, and we have many more to look forward to. I want to thank everyone that is watching currently. If I might just mention real quick, in 2 weeks, we will have a man named Bill Ludwig, who has written a very interesting book called Chasing Labyrinths, A Guide to Labyrinths of Connecticut and Rhode Island. He had a long career in Connecticut with Garland Publishing, got interested in labyrinths, and I admit that it isn't a topic I know anything about, but apparently there's a number of labyrinths in Connecticut and Rhode Island, and he's going to show us around. And so I invite everyone that is watching tonight to join us in 2 weeks. And certainly until the next time, we are blessed with having Dr. Markward enlighten us about classical music. So thank you, Dr. Markward, and thank you all this evening. Thank you so much.
I'll just go in to get us out. Mm-hmm.